Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Professor and the Coed, Scandal and Murder at the Ohio State University by Mark Gribben, narrated by Brian P. Craig. Author's note: The 1920s was an era of more than flappers, bootleg liquor, and the lost generation of F. Scott Fitzgerald. The decade was indeed roaring, but more importantly, the 1920s are nearly equal to the 1960s in terms of complex social upheaval in the United States. During the third decade of the 20th century, the staid morality of the Victorian era was firmly and finally being put to rest. Young people, particularly college students, were rejecting the traditional values of their parents and establishing their own standards of acceptable behavior. The youth of the 1920s were at once the product of change and the agents of change, wrote sociologist Paula Fass in The Damned and the Beautiful, American Youth in the 1920s. They existed at a strategic point in history when their actions really did make a difference. I only bring this before the listener to point out that Theora Hix's behavior was not so far outside the mainstream of her age cohort as many of the people involved in this case might have believed. A large percentage of well-educated young people of both genders was no less sexually adventurous than Theora, although, as Fass points out in her book, most college women were monogamous and only engaged in intercourse with partners when the prospect of marriage was high. Studies at the time estimated that about 50% of college women were not virgins and more than 90% engaged in some sort of sexual activity. Part 1. Crime and Investigation. Discovery. Paul Krumlauf and Milton Miller never did find out who was the better shot. It was a fine summer morning, one of the last bright days before the arrival of the Great Depression. A powerful rainstorm had blown through the area the previous day, finally clearing away a stalled mass of warm air that had long since gone stale, leaving high, wispy tendrils of clouds in place of the ominous thunderheads that had been hovering close to the ground. A warm breeze was at work drying the weeds. The smell of wet earth lingered in the air. The two teenage friends had been boasting of their sharpshooting skills and decided to settle the good-natured dispute by firing off a few rounds at a gun range on the outskirts of Columbus, Ohio. Instead, they raised the curtain on a short morality play that thrust talk of infidelity and promiscuity, aphrodisiacs and illicit drugs, lust and murder onto the front pages of newspapers and into homes across the country. The secret double life of a not-so-innocent young woman would be laid bare, and a quiet middle-aged married man would go down in history as the only Ohio State University professor and Olympic gold medalist to die in the electric chair. About 10:30 a.m. on Friday, June 14, 1929, Krumlauf and Miller were wading through knee-high weeds toward the firing line at the New York Central Railroad shooting range just west of the city limits to settle their bet when they saw a farmer plowing a field to the east. The boys headed over to warn the man, 76-year-old Ephraim Johnson, that they were about to do some shooting. On their way across the field, they stumbled upon a pile of something in the brush. In a way, fortune was merciful to the boys when they found the young woman's body. Because she was face down in the tall weeds, they were spared the sight of the dozen or so wounds on her face caused by the hammer blows her killer had rained down. They did not see the gaping cut that ran across her throat nearly from ear to ear, and the bizarre appearance of her face turned china white for want of blood. They did not know of the puncture wound to her ear where her killer had inserted his knife. Because the boys had found her just a little more than 12 hours after she had been murdered, the eggs laid in the open wounds by blowflies attracted to the dead flesh had not yet hatched into maggots. Her body was badly beaten and bloody, but what might have remained for the boys to discover could have been much worse. At first, they thought the crumpled body was an abandoned pile of clothes. After all, finding discarded clothing, liquor bottles, and other refuse at the shooting range was not unusual. A convenient drive from the Ohio State campus and the city, a secluded spot not far from the Scioto River Road and the exclusive Scioto Country Club, the shooting range was popular with sportsmen and young people for different reasons. The remote location and the tall weeds made the area a prime location for necking. The term had recently replaced spooning in the slang of youths, giving it the moniker Shirttail Alley. More than a few couples had been ticketed there by the local constable and fined by the Justice of the Peace for fornicating. The murder victim, in fact, had been arrested here and paid a $20 fine under a false name less than a year before. The boys first heard rather than saw the crime scene because of the flies buzzing around the pooled and drying blood. Once the boys realized they had not found some discarded and forgotten clothing and that the thing in front of them was a person, the thoughts of the shooting contest were lost forever. They shrank from the sight and called to Johnson, who responded in his typical casual manner to the boys' frantic summons. Johnson agreed to watch over the body while the boys brought the police. Johnson apparently was nonplussed by the gruesome find. After he let the boys leave, he left the scene himself to put his horses away in the barn. The boys raced Krumlauf's jalopy to the Parsons Avenue police station about 10 minutes away. It took them an hour to return to the range with Corporal John May and Officer Emmett Cloud, who secured the crime scene and waited for the arrival of the coroner and a crime scene photographer from the state's Bureau of Identification. Arriving soon after the first responders, Coroner William Murphy was met by a gruesome scene in the high grass. The woman's body was lying on its left side, with her right arm extended in front, the hand clutching a bloody handkerchief. Her throat had been slashed, apparent stab wounds were visible on her back and abdomen, her nose had been flattened, her face was battered almost beyond recognition, and most of the bones in her skull were broken. Her hair was matted with blood. She was clothed in a blood-saturated, belted brown crepe dress with white collar that covered a combination suit ripped from the waist to the hem, the garment which modern times had developed, two garments in one made to meet the needs of the busy girl, wrote Anne Schattenstein, one of the many reporters who covered the case. Murphy, who had been coroner for Franklin County since 1921 and had seen his share of murder victims, waited until Homer Richter, the police photographer, took a couple of pictures and then helped him turn the body over. The first thing he noticed were the four bruises on the inside of her left arm and the corresponding bruise on the outside. "She was held by someone with a strong grip," he said, gesturing toward the purple contusions. Murphy assumed this meant she had tried to flee from her attacker. The coroner noted that the victim's throat had been cut from left to right with a sharp knife and that there were three wounds on her forehead, two blows on the left side and one above her nose that he said later had the appearance of a puncture within an incised wound, which I supposed was made by a blow. One of the wounds above her eye was large and deep enough that he could insert his finger into it, he said. Affixing the time of death was a simple affair. When the men turned over the body, Murphy saw that the woman was wearing a wristwatch. The crystal had fallen out, and the hands had stopped at 9:58. That clue corresponded with the temperature and rigor condition of the body. The watch still worked. Once Constable John Guy lifted the arm, it started to run again. At first, Murphy wondered if he was dealing with a horrible sex crime. I noticed a wound in the right groin and that her underclothing had been cut practically by the same instrument to a distance up to where would be practically a band and then another distance about 3 inches above the band, he testified later. But the dress had not been cut in that position. After his cursory review of the scene, Murphy ordered the unidentified woman to be taken to the Glenn L. Myers mortuary for an autopsy. Early on in the investigation, Columbus Division of Police detectives drew some erroneous conclusions, demonstrating the folly of reading too much into a crime scene. Their incorrect assumption of a lunatic on the loose — the Columbus Hospital for the Insane was a stone's throw away from the scene — was fast revised, thanks to the newspapers that did not sit for long on the discovery of the body of a young woman so brutally murdered. Shortly after the Columbus Evening Dispatch published the first sketchy reports that Friday afternoon, the police were redirected from their search for a homicidal maniac who snatched his victim from the city and dumped her corpse in that lonely field to an even more shocking investigation, which revealed not only that the deceased had gone to the shooting range willingly, but also that she knew her killer in a most intimate way. That is not to say that the newspapers were overly helpful or even enlightened. The Dispatch's rival paper, the Columbus Citizen, reported that unnamed Washington, D.C. scientists believed the murder was the result of the blind and absolutely uncontrolled, even unconscious, rage of the epileptic. Discounting the possibility that the killer was a sadist who had gone too far in punishing his victim, or that he was delusional or obsessive, because even those madmen will stop before more is done to the victim than is necessary to extinguish life, the Citizen claimed that epileptics have no such control. "During the course of the seizure, he is absolutely unconscious of his acts," the unsigned and unsourced article states. "He is in an amnesiac state. He is not aware of what he is doing at the time and has no memory of it afterwards." The newspaper's clarion call of murder achieved its objective. It sold papers and prompted people with information to step forward. In some cases, police are besieged with false leads, sham confessions from the mentally ill, and specious theories from armchair detectives. Not so in this case. With very few exceptions, the tips passed along to the police actually had some bearing on this murder. The first task in any murder investigation is to identify the victim, which in this case did not prove difficult. Around the same time Krumlauf and Miller were breathlessly telling of their gruesome discovery, two sisters, Alice and Beatrice Buston, were wondering why their roommate, Theora Hix, had not returned home the night before. The three women shared a small flat above the State Drug and Supply Company, about a block away from Mack Hall on the OSU campus. As a roommate, Theora was an enigma to the Buston sisters, but she had never stayed away from the apartment overnight without telling them. They were perplexed, but not overly concerned. Theora led her own life, quite separate from the Buston sisters. "We didn't become alarmed when she didn't come in when it became bedtime Thursday night, for she was in the habit of taking walks in the evening, and when she didn't return at all during the night, we thought she had stayed with the Jeffers, where she used to stay with the children occasionally," Alice said later. "It wasn't until late in the day that we began to get worried and called the police." When the papers hit the street on the late afternoon with news of the murder, the Buston sisters were not the only ones to suspect they knew the identity of the body found at the shooting range. Bertha Dillon, a switchboard operator at the Ohio State University Hospital, had been more than a little miffed when the young woman she had been training, Theora Hix, had not returned from a date the night before. Hatless and attired in a brown dress trimmed with a flashy rhinestone belt that was uncharacteristically gaudy for her, Theora sat with Bertha for an hour or so Thursday evening, learning the layout of the switchboard, until she announced that she had a date and would be back shortly. "She came in Thursday evening to see me operate the board," Bertha told police. "She appeared about the same as usual. She never smiled much. But shortly after 7:30, she told me that she would have to be going, but would be back later. She smiled when she spoke of her date. It was one of the few times I had ever seen her smile. She was always so quiet and serious-minded." The police brought the Buston sisters and Bertha Dillon to the mortuary, where they viewed the body of the shooting range murder victim. All identified the battered corpse as Theora Kathleen Hix, an Ohio State University medical student 2 months shy of her 25th birthday. Theora. Police now had a name, and with it came a photograph of the victim. A casual sorority photo showing a fresh-skinned, moderately attractive young woman with close-cut hair, clear bright eyes averted from the camera, and a knowing expression somewhere between a Mona Lisa smile and a smirk. It is, of Theora Hix, a perfect representation. Enigmatic and beguiling, a mysteriously simple photograph that hints at carefully concealed secrets. The investigation now centered on tracing Theora's last earthly hours for clues to her killer's identity and explanations for why she had to die. The first solid lead came from taxicab driver Earl Nichols, who had picked up a distracted young woman answering Theora's description near Neal Avenue around the time Theora left Bertha Dillon at the OSU switchboard. Neal Avenue is one of the main north-south streets that borders on the OSU campus and runs directly into downtown Columbus. "She seemed all worried," he told the dispatch. "She told me to drive to the hilltop and said she wanted to go by way of Grandview Avenue. She said she thought she might see a man in a coupe. She asked me for cigarettes 3 times going over, but didn't smoke more than a part of each one," he added. When the woman failed to find what she was looking for at Sullivan Avenue and Eureka Street in the Hilltop District, she told Nichols to drive back to Neal. "She asked for 2 more cigarettes on the way back, but didn't smoke more than 2 puffs on each one," he said. "She was all fidgety about something." Theora's nervous behavior was not the only reason Nichols remembered the fare. Theora directed the cabbie to drive a 16-mile circuit along a meandering route that was much longer than necessary. Directing Nichols to use Grandview Avenue took Theora in the opposite direction of the Hilltop area. The trip that took nearly an hour might have been accomplished in half that time if they had used the most direct route then available. Police learned later that the trip took Theora past a number of locations of significance in her secret life. Nichols dropped the woman off at Neal and 10th Avenues near the OSU hospital and didn't give the fare a second thought until the papers reported the murder. Other witnesses picked up the story. More than one person confirmed that the woman Nichols let off was seen in the company of an older, bald-headed, bespectacled man driving a blue coupe. The deeper the police looked into the life of their murder victim for clues, the more mysterious Theora became. Everyone they located who was acquainted with Theora really did not know her at all. Detectives found no shortage of persons willing to step forward to say what a pleasant, polite, hard-working young woman she was, but no one had the least bit of information about her that was not superficial. The Theora everyone knew was a quiet, intelligent, somewhat standoffish co-worker or roommate, nothing more. She was as inscrutable as the Sphinx, surrendering her secrets to no one. "Theora was an unusual girl in some ways," Alice Buston said. "She lived here in the apartment with Beatrice and me since last September, but we didn't know much about her." "She played tennis on the municipal courts near the shooting range, and golf, and liked to take walks," the Buston sisters said. She was a good worker and showed up on time, said her boss in the veterinary school's stenographer's pool. She came here after the conclusion of her examinations for full-time work, but no one in the office really knew her, and we never saw her with anyone except another girl who called for her for luncheon, Mrs. J.H. Wright, assistant to the dean of the OSU Graduate School, told reporters, hungry for any scrap of information about the reclusive murder victim. The newspapers launched their own investigations into the background of the mysterious victim. The less people knew of her, the more driven the papers became to solve the riddle that was Theora Hix. Those who spoke kindly could only call her shy and retiring. The less charitable called Theora moody. Of men, however, everyone was of the same opinion. Theora had little interest in them, and anything she did with men she kept to herself. She chatted freely with us, but both Alice and I knew that it was practically useless to ask her how she liked her date the preceding night, what she did, where she went, or with whom she dated, said classmate Flora Petticord of Zanesville, Ohio. She wouldn't tell us. She seldom dated, but her acquaintances and roommates said she might have been making time with an older gentleman who was connected to the university. She did not talk about it. They did not press her and had no idea who that man might have been. She never told us a word, and we never attempted to draw her into such conversation, Petticord said, adding that rumors were persistent that she'd been keeping company with a man and that a few months ago had a quarrel with him. After that, she appeared to enjoy herself more with her girlfriends. She added ominously that there were additional rumors that Theora had once again taken up with that man. Theora had always been a reticent date, friends recalled. When we had a party, it was always necessary to make a blind date for Theora, a high school classmate tracked down in Muskegon, Michigan, told the Dispatch. She never wanted to go with the same man twice. Detectives going through Theora's belongings came across her bank passbooks, which only deepened the mystery. The investigators found one account at the Buckeye Building and Loan Association that contained $615, and another that indicated she had closed an account at the Columbian Building and Loan Association containing 1,000.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.